again, everybody. So today we're going to be discussing working with buyers like a top producer. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Desi Rodriguez. I am a licensed real estate instructor and broker. I sit on the real estate council board at Florida International University. And this week I actually just got announced as Who's Who in Real Estate by Miami Agent Magazine. So I just threw that in there and I'm just going to go in and get started because it is very dense. I just want to point out that this is really a 6-hour class that I teach my agents, and it's something that I'm going to give to you guys in a lot of little golden nuggets in 25, 30 minutes. So I'm going to run through it. If we can just leave the questions for the end, that'll be great. Today, we're going to cover mindset, the role of a buyer's agent, buyer info sheet, how to create inventory, winning multiple offers, working efficiently. And I have a secret at the end that's RR. And no, I'm not giving away a Rolls Royce, but it's just valuable. So the first one is mindset. And the first one that I want to get into is really the advisor versus the salesperson. And more than anything, I think people have mentioned this throughout the entire day, is you really have to treat real estate like if it was a business, because this is not a hobby, this is a career. So you really have to come in and invest time. I know in all of the different topics, and you've heard from top producers throughout the day, that they invest in different tools, classes. Some people invest in coaching. Other people use accountability partners. So you really need to come in and invest like if this was a business. We don't have a lot of overhead as an independent contractor. You don't really pay for an office or anything like that. So you really need to come in and invest the money in the tools and software that's going to help you take the business to the next level. The next one is time per hour. And I know this has been beat up all day today, but I take it one step further. Obviously, everyone here should be an independent contractor. You probably don't get paid per hour, but you still want to measure how much time you put in for each one of your clients and to really measure how much money you get back and what that equates to per hour. The biggest thing is to remember that you're going to get paid whether you show someone 25 houses or 5 houses, the same amount of money. Whether you spend 3 months with them or 1 week, you're going to get paid the same. So it really comes down to make sure that you're maximizing your time and your productivity. The next one is to say no, which plays into the last one. And this is, you know, one of my favorite quotes from Steve Jobs. He said, he is as proud of the things that they didn't do as the things that they did do. Guys, you don't have to be scared to say no to a client. You don't have to be scared to say no to a networking event. Everybody's been talking all day about time blocking, and you do need to manage your calendar and you need to do your income producing activities. And if something does not align, like if you have a networking event, but you're supposed to be prospecting should supersede that. You need to make money and you need to treat this like a business. And the last one is to be positive. I'm a very big firm believer in affirmations, and whatever you put out there, you're going to get back. If you wake up every day and you know and you think that you're going to be a top producer, chances are that you're going to be a top producer when you put in the work. But if you come in and you just say, oh, I don't know if I'm cut out for this, or my clients are, you know, they're too picky, or I don't know if I'm going to close that deal, then chances are you're going to struggle. So I'm a firm believer of whatever you put out there is what you're going to get back. So make sure to always remain positive. So I want to get into the role of a buyer's agent, because it's a lot more than just finding properties on the MLS, sending them to your clients and scheduling showings and opening a door. There's a lot more that goes into that. And the first one is to understand your client. You need to make sure that you know who they are, what it is that they do, their type of personality, and the reason that they're buying. These are things that are going to help you, help them find their dream home, but it's also going to help you really build that relationship with them. So it's very important to start off with understanding your client. The next one is to filter. So clients can go on any online portal, any IDX website, Zillow, Realtor.com, and find a list of every property that's available for sale. They come to you for more help. They come for you to filter these properties out. Your job is to send them what meets their exact criteria, not just say, okay, they're looking for a 3-2 between 500 and 550,000 in so-and-so area. There's probably a lot more details that go into it, which I get into a little bit later. And that is really your job. You shouldn't go and send them 50 properties that are for sale, because for that, they just go on Zillow and look for themselves and they won't really need you for that. The next one is to negotiate. And this is something that I believe every realtor, whether you're working with buyers, listings, investors, whatever it is, should be good at. You need to be very good at getting your clients the best deal. And by this, it does not always mean the lowest price. Sometimes you have a client that needs a little bit extra time to close, or they need a little bit of a seller concession because they're short for closing costs. Sometimes, you know, we're still in low inventory in South Florida, and chances are you might run into a situation with a multiple offers on a property, and you need to make sure that you know how to win that multiple offer situation to make sure your client is able to buy their dream home. And the next one is to interpret the data. As I mentioned, they can find any property on any site, and all of those sites also have a lot of information out there. So you want to make sure that you're able to explain any questions that they may have seen online. For example, if a listing is cash only, your client might not understand why, and you need to be able to explain that to them. If it's a short sale, they might not know what that process entails. It's very common to have two very similar houses in the same neighborhood with very different property taxes. It could be because one has homestead exemption and the other doesn't. You need to know all of these things and be able to interpret that data for your clients so that you really come off as the advisor and the expert and you educate them properly. So the buyer info sheet for me, it's my version of the buyer consultation. And this is something that I do upfront with every single one of my clients. If I don't have this sheet of paper filled out, I will not go out and show them a house because I don't understand yet what it is that they're looking for. So I usually start, and this is the exact order that I go in, and I start from the least intrusive questions to ending with talking about money, which will be on the next slide. And these are things that not only help you understand the client, but you really start building that relationship, because once you get past the bedrooms and bathrooms, if you ask them, do you guys need a garage? Oh yes, my husband keeps a lot of things, you know, and we store a lot of stuff and we rather keep it in the garage. If you ask them about the pool, they might start telling you about how they want their kids entertained during the summer, and the pool is the perfect place to do that. The one story versus two story. I work a lot of single family and townhomes. So that's one of my favorite questions, because you run into, they have in-laws that, you know, can't walk up and down the stairs. So you start the conversation of, well, if it has a master bedroom on the first floor, is that suitable? So it really, you start diving into their life and you really start understanding what their needs are. So there's more questions. I encourage you guys to take a picture of this. I mean, I'm not going to go one by one, but this is just what I use. And it actually continues on this next slide. And this is actually one of my secret questions that makes clients think. And I wrote down here to give you guys two examples. And it's features that you cannot live without. That is a question that helps me seal a lot of deals a lot faster. Letty from Miami Springs, I helped her buy a home in 2018. And she had a very specific request. She told me, I have small children and I have dogs. I spend a lot of time in the kitchen. You know, we're very outdoorsy. I would love to have a kitchen that overlooks the backyard. So that right away told me what I needed to go find. In Miami Springs, there was only two properties matching her criteria. We went, we saw both of them. One wasn't really renovated. She didn't like it. The other one she fell in love with and she bought it. We placed the offer. There was no competition at the time. And she ended up buying that house. That was one day, two showings for that client, all because I took the time and did the buyer info sheet up front. If you don't do this, you might go out 3-4 different times, 5-6 different times throughout weeks with the same buyer, and they'll give you little bits and pieces as they figure out what they really want if you don't ask them up front. The next one is Leo, and he bought a home with me in Hialeah. This client was actually last year. And it was really interesting because his response to the feature that he cannot live without, he said he wanted a house that felt like home. And in my mind, I'm like, okay, that's super easy. I'm going to go look for a fix and flip from an investor, something that's completely renovated. But I decided to take it one step further. And I'm like, Leo, what feels like home to you? And he started telling me about how he grew up in Cuba and he wants something that reminds him of home. Coincidentally, it's in Hialeah, so that worked out great. But it's one of those things that he really said, I don't really like the shiny and the brand new. I want something that has a little bit of character. And that right there told me to remove everything that was completely remodeled and fix and flip properties from the equation. I ended up showing him 5 properties in 2 different days and he went under contract. So it's one of those things that I can't stress enough. You're gonna get paid the same whether you do 20 showings or you do 5 showings. And this is something that clients really appreciate because you take the time to, you know, understand them, build that relationship, but also you are saving them time. You're saving yourself time, which is very important because your time per hour is going to go up as I mentioned earlier, but you're also saving them time. They'd rather not see 25 houses that they're not gonna like if they don't have to. And then I get into the other questions that dive a little bit deeper, if they own a house or if they rent one, if they're pre-qualified, the loan type, the budget. I don't think I have to mention that obviously you guys get your client pre-approved before you take them out for a showing. The next one is to work efficiently. I hear from a lot of realtors that they spend a lot of time on the MLS. They spend half their day on the MLS. I don't understand how. You should go on MLS the very first time that after you fill out your buyer info sheet, you know exactly what your client is looking for. You come in and all of these details, you're going to fill them into the MLS, whether it's the garage, whether it's a pool if it's mandatory for them, if it's a one-story versus two-story, if the property has an association. Once you fill that out and you start your search, before you even start going through properties, the first thing that you should do is set up the auto search. Like, that is your free assistant. You will never really, unless the criteria changes, have to go back in and look for properties. I don't understand why people spend all day on MLS when you could use this tool. I personally take it one step further and I use the concierge mode to send the properties to myself first. I want to make sure that it meets 100% the criteria, and there are MLS issues sometimes where an agent accidentally puts a $500,000 property for sale for $500. They missed the last three zeros and my client is only looking for $450, and I don't want them wondering why I'm sending them a $500,000 property. So there's a lot more tools out there, and you guys should really just find what's helpful for you. But things like this, like MLS, RPR, the Miami Association of Realtors has great classes. They actually have three sessions for Matrix, just to learn Matrix. And it's something that you guys need to do because it's software that you should be using day in and day out. And you really need to learn the software that you're using in order to be productive. The next one is creating inventory. As I mentioned earlier, we obviously have a shortage of inventory in many places in South Florida. And it's one of those things that the average agent comes in, and if there's nothing on the market for your buyer at the moment, they'll just sit there and say, okay, well, we're going to wait. The auto search is on. We're going to wait for something to pop up. Well, you should go one step above, because having that client sit there on the sidelines for 2-3 months until that house comes up is going to give you a lot of issues. Number one, they might get discouraged. Number two, they might just call it quits. Or when you finally find that house that's perfect for them, it might be perfect for 7 or 8 other people. And now you're in a multiple offer situation, which I'm going to teach you in a little bit how you can win that, but it'd be great to avoid it altogether. So about 7% of the homes, and this was as of 2018, were sold for sale by owner. I recommend just going on Zillow or whatever site and looking for sale by owners. Chances are they're willing to pay you 2.5-3% commission as a buyer's agent. They might not want to pay a listing agent, but you have the buyer. So go look for sale by owners. The other thing that I love to mention is that 71% of expired listings end up relisting on the market. So instead of waiting for that inventory to relist with another agent and you taking your buyer, you can either skip trace those owners' numbers, or you can just go ahead and door knock if it's a property that's suitable for your buyer and go create that inventory for your buyer. I actually have an example where one of the agents on my team did this. They ended up showing an expired listing to a buyer. The buyer ended up not liking it, but he had such a meaningful conversation with that seller that we ended up being the ones that relisted that property for sale. So he walked in trying to do something with his buyer and he walked out with a listing. This is a class about how to work with buyers, but I think if anybody walks out of a showing with a listing, that's always a good thing. So this is my way on how to win multiple offers. And the first one should be common sense, but when I've been on the listing side, I've actually had agents submit an offer without ever having a conversation with me. You want to come in and make sure, guys, that you talk to the listing agent. Don't just assume that they want to close as fast as possible and that they want the most amount of money. Price is important, but there could be factors going on that you might not know of. Maybe the seller needs to stay after closing with a post-occupancy agreement. Maybe they're looking for a 45-60-day closing because they're relocating. Maybe they just want the most amount of money and they need to close fast. You need to know the situation so that you know how to structure your offer accordingly. The next one is to place an aggressive offer. As I mentioned, price is very important, but it's not always everything. If you submit the highest offer, but you have a $500 escrow, chances are that your offer is not going to be taken seriously. The next one is financing. You want to make sure that you make your offers, you know, presentable and professional as possible and include all of the documents that need to be in there. The closing date, you know, if the seller, you play that based on what the seller is looking for. If they're looking to close later, you're obviously going to structure that to what they want. If they want to close as fast as possible, you're going to pick up the phone, call the lender and say, hey, how fast do you think you can close this deal? That last one is the inspection period. I know that the standard on the contract is 15 days. It does not take 15 days to do an inspection on the average property. Most inspectors can get out there in 48 hours. I know one of the sponsors today is TrueView Inspections. Them and many other inspectors are able to give you an inspection report that same day. So you can have an inspection report in 2 days. If termite comes out, if they recommend to have a plumber come out, you still have another 5-6 days if you put a 7-8 day inspection period. Nobody wants to tie the property up and have you take your time with 15 days to do inspections. The next one, and this is gonna be the biggest secrets that you guys should really take away today, are additional clauses that you can add to the contract. The first one is the acceleration clause. This one is one of my favorites. Both of these, by the way, I guarantee you, if you use either one of them or both of them, it's going to put your offer to the top of the list when you have a multiple offer situation. The acceleration clause is that you stipulate in the contract that the buyer will pay $1,000, $3,000, whatever the amount is, above any written and verifiable offer up to X amount. So that's already positioning you that you don't have to guess. Now you're giving yourself the advantage, hey, I'll beat out whatever offer up to this amount. The appraisal clause I love to use, it's very common that, you know, you list a property for what it's worth, but you still receive 7, 8, 9, 10 offers. So in that case, the listing agent is like, okay, you can offer me $20,000 above, but it's an appraise. So what good does that really do me? You can come in and put an appraisal clause where you obviously are gonna offer whatever you offer, but you also say, in case the appraisal falls low, buyer is willing to pay $5,000, $10,000, whatever that amount is, above the appraised value. That's something that's really going to help you. And the last one is to involve the lender. You want to come in and obviously provide the pre-approval and the DU, which is very standard when you submit the offer, but you also want to get the lender involved to call the listing agent. Let them have a conversation and explain the buyer's qualifications to them. It's going to make the listing agent feel a lot more comfortable, and now they're also going to have rapport with the lender. So the lender can pick up the phone and say, hey, this person is a W-2 employee. They've been working for the past 10 years at the same job. They have a 700 or they have a great credit score. And obviously with the buyer's permission, but once they release that, it makes it a lot more comfortable and easier for the sellers to be able to make a decision. The next one and the last one that I brought to you guys is the RR. I told you it's not a Rolls Royce, but to any business, you guys need reviews and referrals. So I'm gonna jump into the reviews, and I see a lot of agents struggle. They wait till they close the deal and then they ask the review. The buyers get busy and, you know, they're moving, they get frustrated. They have a lot of stuff going on. They might be trying to remodel the home or getting changes done beforehand. So I encourage you to ask for the review when they're the happiest, when they're excited, they're nervous, one to two days before the closing date. And my favorite thing to do that I can't do anymore, unfortunately, since I'm a broker now, I just blame my coach, but blame your broker. Tell them, hey guys, you know, I know everything went great. We're good to go so-and-so day. Do you mind leaving me a review online? I'm under a lot of pressure from my broker to build my online presence. That kind of puts a little bit of authority on it. They're gonna feel bad. It's not like you're just asking for it. It's like your boss is asking for it. And it's something that really helps you solidify that. Worst case scenario, they don't give you the review, where you're going to see both of them or whoever's buying the property the day of closing. So there you go. The next one is referrals. And I know Joanna was just mentioning this. You can never stop prospecting. And what most agents do is come in and, you know, they just close the buyer. They don't talk to them for maybe a month or two or three after the closing day. And then they'll pick up the phone when they have no more business and ask for referrals. I like to ask for referrals at the closing table. I take a sheet of paper and it has 5 spaces for names and 5 spaces for phone numbers. And I ask them typically before they sign all of their paperwork, before their hands are tired of signing, I come in when they're making a copy of the ID or they're bringing us something to drink. And I ask them, hey guys, you know, I'm under a lot of pressure. I'm in a competition. Do you guys know anybody who might be willing to buy, sell, or invest in real estate right now? It's a fact that it's a lot harder for people to tell you no in person rather than over the phone. So they're a lot more likely. The other thing is that you have everybody that's involved at the table. So if it's a married couple, you might have the husband and wife there, and that's a lot more likely that you're going to get 3, 4, maybe even the 5 referrals. The reason that I put 5 is because you're probably going to end up with 3. If you put 3, you might only end up with 1. So it gives them a little bit more pressure to put more referrals there. And that's actually everything that I got for today. I actually know that this went by really quick. There's a lot more materials I mentioned. This is really a 6-hour course. But if you guys want the buyer info sheet and a grid of sphere of influence script to get referrals that I have, feel free to email me and I'll just reply and send it over to you guys.